بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين الحمد لله الله سبحانه وتعالى has given us توفيق to be reminded and to learn and remind each other about the lives of the greatest of people. The greatest of people. Look at every aspect of life. Look at every faculty that exists. You always find the successful ones and those who flop and fail, except in one fraternity, and that is in the galaxy of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, because every one of them are the best, and every one of them triumphed and succeeded and fulfilled their objective. Not one flop, not one dropout. Every Sahabi, Allah has guaranteed that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum are the best. And every Sahabi, وَكُلَّ وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الْحُسْنَى. And what's amazing is that every Sahabi we study and we learn about just enhances and inspires us more and more. That's why with regards to Sahaba radiallahu anhum, it's actually very difficult to have a favorite, because everyone is like a favorite. We study about one and he becomes the favorite, and then we learn about the other, and that Sahabi and Sahabiyah radiallahu anhum wa anhun become the favorites. Allah give us tawfiq to spend our lives in learning about them and uplifting the lives of our children through the lives of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah forgive us through the Sahaba radiallahu anhum's intercession, through his grace and mercy. The Sahabi we learn about is a very, very great Sahabi, like they all are. His name is Shaddad bin Aus bin Thabit bin Mundhir radiallahu anhu. Just to understand his lineage and family better, we all heard about the famous poet of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't even have to tell you that Sahabi's name, who would render poetry on the minbar of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the praises of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and when anyone would pick on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would defend Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say that this Sahabi's words are even stronger on the hearts of the enemy than even spears being rained upon them. That Sahabi who would say, وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَنَقَاطُ عَيْنِي وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبِ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَنَقَاطُ عَيْنِي وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبِ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. O my Nabi, أَحْسَنُ مِنْك, more beautiful than you. لَمْ تَرَ قَطُّ عَيْنِي, my eye has never fallen on. My eye has never seen more beautiful than you. And more magnificent than you, no woman has given birth to. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِّن كُلِّ عَيْبِ. Allah has made you perfect and free from every fault and blemish. O my Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it is as though Allah asked you how you want to be created. And on your demand and requisite and desire, Allah made you as you required and wanted. That's how perfectly my Allah made you, O Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who is the Sahabi? Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu. So Shaddad is the nephew of Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu. Some other amazing words of Hassan radiallahu anhu, wherein he says, أغر عليه للنبوة خاتم من الله مشهود يلوح ويشهد وضم الإله اسم النبي إلى اسمه إذا قال في الخمس المؤذن أشهد وشق له من اسمه ليجله فذو العرش محمود وهذا محمد فأمسى سراجا مستنيرا وهاديا يلوح كما لاح الصقيل المهند وأنذرنا نارا وبشر جنة وعلمنا الإسلام فالله نحمد. هذا الحسان رضي الله عنه says, أرو, my Nabi is so beautiful and bright and nurani. upon him is the khatam, the seal of anbiya, لِلنُّبُوَّةِ khatamu. That is apparent, yaluhu, that is apparent, that is seen from far. وَيَشْهَدُ, and that bears testimony to his nubuwah. He is so great, my Nabi is so great, Hassan radiallahu anhu says, وَضَمَّ الْإِلَهُ إِسْمَ النَّبِيِّ إِلَى اسْمِهِ. My Allah has connected his Nabi's name to his name. That every time the Muadhin says, أَشْهَدُ, meaning, أَشْهَدُ أَلَّا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, it is followed by, أَشْهَدُ أَنَّ مُحَمَّدًا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. My Nabi is so great that Allah gave him such names that are of such praise. Like Allah's name is Mahmood, that Allah is the one who is praised and all the time worthy of praise. And Hada Muhammad, and Allah named his beloved Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That he is Sirajan Muniran, that lantern, that lamp, Mustaniran, that has so much of light and gives off light to humanity. Wahadiyan. Ulama explained so beautifully why the Sahabi radiallahu anhu refers to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a lantern and as a lamp, when he is much more brighter than a lamp. Allah's Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is more beautiful than the moon also. He is more beautiful than the sun also. But the lamp is so beautiful that one lamp makes many lamps. The candle can light many candles. One becomes two, two becomes four, four becomes eight, eight becomes 16. And like that it is spread to the four corners of the world. That there are so many who emulate Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and become the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he says that clear is his deen, like that sharp, sharp shining sword, how clear he made the deen. He warned us about the punishment of Allah, and he gave glad tidings of the Jannah of Allah, and he taught us Islam. So it is Allah who we praise, who blessed us with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Hassan radiallahu anhu, there isn't an event in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam except that Hassan radiallahu anhu would comment in his prolific way. He would render it in poetry. That's why there's books called Diwan, an epilogue, a compilation of just poetry and the words of Hassan bin Thabit radiallahu anhu. Shaddad radiallahu anhu's father was Aus bin Thabit. That was the brother of Hassan radiallahu anhu. And he was among the early Muslims, among the people who embraced Islam in the early stages. From those, the Sab'een, the 70, who took bay'ah at the bay'ah of Aqaba. And he also participated in Badr and expeditions after that. His father sacrificed for Allah's deen till he became shaheed in Uhud. But when Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated to Medina Munawwara, the family of Shaddad, meaning his father and his entire family, were blessed because they welcomed and were the hosts of the blessed daughter of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ruqayya binti Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and her husband Uthman bin Affan bin Nurain radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. So this couple, Uthman radiyallahu anhu and his blessed wife Ruqayya radiyallahu anha, lived and stayed in the home of Aus radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, the father of Shaddad radiyallahu anhu. So Shaddad radiyallahu anhu had the opportunity to make khidmah of the blessed family members and the household of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And how fortunate was the mother of Shaddad radiallahu anha, that she took care of Ruqayya radiallahu anha. And Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam made mu'akha, this brotherhood between the Muhajireen and the Ansar. And the brotherhood took place between Aus radiallahu anhu and Uthman radiallahu anhu. That was the close relationship between the two of them. And how fortunate was Shaddad radiallahu anhu, managing to learn the deen of Allah direct from the senior Sahaba radiallahu anhu, from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, from Uthman radiallahu anhu, because he was like his father's brother. That's why Shaddad radiallahu anhu was so wise and so knowledgeable. Hazrat Abu Darda radiallahu anhu would say, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ فَقِيهًا وَإِنَّ فَقِيهَ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ شَدَّادُ بْنُ أَوْسِ. Every ummah has a very high ranking faqih, someone who understands deen fully and completely. He understands the importance and the wisdom behind every injunction of sharia. And among the foremost of the fuqaha of this ummah, the jurists of this ummah, the foremost and the forerunners in that field is Shaddad, in understanding the deen fully and totally and explaining the deen to humanity. The forerunners of those among them is Hazrat Shaddad bin Aws al-Ansari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Something else very interesting about the family of Shaddad radiyallahu anhu is the fact that his uncle, Hassan radiyallahu anhu, and Hassan radiyallahu anhu's father, Thabit, and Hassan radiyallahu anhu's grandfather, Mundir, and Thabit's grandfather, so the great-grandfather of Hassan radiyallahu anhu, and the great-great-grandfather of Shaddad radiyallahu anhu. All of them from Hassan to Aws, from Hassan to Thabit to Mundir, and Mundir's father, all of them lived 120 years each. So Allah Ta'ala blessed them with very long lives. There were quite a few Sahaba radiyallahu anhum who Allah blessed with extensively long lives. They are known among the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum as Mu'ammarin. Because obviously a long portion of their life was before the advent of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and certain sections of their life was during Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's time and after our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Amongst these Sahaba radiyallahu anhum are Mawala bin Kuthayf bin Hamal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He came to meet Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and embraced Islam when he was 20. And he narrates some amazing ahadith. And after that he brought the zakat of his camels to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he then remained in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's company until Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this transitory world. Then he remained in the company of Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu because of the love of knowledge. So he remained 100 years as a Muslim. And he was known as Dhal Lisanain, the man of two tongues, because of his eloquence. So this Sahabi radiyallahu anhu lived for over 100 years. Another Sahabi, Munqidh bin Amr radiyallahu anhu, he lived for 130 years. Then we know Hassan radiyallahu anhu and his father and grandfather and great grandfather. And then we also have this Sahabi, Al-Mustaw'iz bin Rabi'a bin Ka'b bin Sa'ad radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Al-Asma'i rahimahullah, a great scholar at that time, says that Abu Amr ibn al-Ala, one of the greatest scholars of Quran at that time, said that Al-Mustaw'iz, and this is reported by Hafid ibn Hajar rahimahullah in his Isabah, that Al-Mustaw'iz radiyallahu anhu, Hazrat Al-Mustaw'iz radiyallahu anhu lived for 320 years. Obviously a lot of that time was before the advent of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says that some reports mention that he was so old that on one occasion in Hajj, another man was pushing him along and helping him and serving him. So someone came and said to him, "Don't you have any shame? The person behind you is old and he's serving you." So he says to him that, "Do you know who is he to me?" He says, "I don't." He says, "This is my grandson." So his grandson was so old and serving him who was much more older. But Allah Ta'ala kept him strong and Allah Ta'ala blessed him with that long life. Another very great Sahabi who lived for such a long period of time was Salman al-Farisi radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Ibn al-Athir rahimahullah quotes the scholars to say that Salman radiyallahu anhu lived 250 years approximately without doubt. So obviously this was not a common thing that happened, that Sahaba radiyallahu anhu lived so long, but these were a few who Allah Ta'ala blessed them. Like Salman radiyallahu anhu, he had such a zest to learn, where he went from tutor to tutor, going to different scholars searching for the truth. So Allah blessed him because of that talab and that love to learn that Allah extended his life till he met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and spent years in the company and the khidmah of Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also something else, just to, while we're on this point, the last Sahabi to leave this world was Amir bin Wathila Abu Tufail radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He left this world 110 Hijri. And amongst them was Anas radiyallahu anhu. He also lived for 103 years. And he left this world 93 Hijri. He was the last Sahabi to leave this world in Basra. And ulama write under his life that when one makes khidmah for Allah's pleasure and he serves others, Allah blesses one in his lifespan. And another anecdote to actually be blessed in one's life, either Allah will extend one's life, and that too is through the will of Allah and Allah's decree. What Allah decrees happens, but Allah blesses one's life through joining family ties and righteous good deeds and showing kindness to humanity. Allah Ta'ala give us tawfiq to join ties and show kindness to the whole of humanity and acquire taqwa in our lives. As we return to Hazrat Shaddad radiyallahu anhu, because of his association with such senior sahaba like Uthman bin Affan radiyallahu anhu, he learned so much of ilm and deen, and he had such ibadah in his life that he was an ardent worshipper of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was an abid, devoted to ibadah. And he was zahid. He abstained from the embellishments and the beautiful things of this world to acquire the pleasures of akhirah. It's reported that at night, Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu, as he would try to rest, he would toss and turn on his bedding as though he was on burning copper and steel. And he couldn't manage to sleep, and he would cry and say, very often he would say, Allahumma inna nara jahannama aqlaqatni fama astati'u an anam. Oh Allah, it is the fire of Jahannam that has made me restless. I cannot sleep. Oh Allah, this worry has taken sleep from my eyes. Oh Allah, I can't even fall off to sleep. So he would spend his entire night in ibadat and tahajjud right till the appearance of Fajr. With the acquisition of knowledge in Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu, he also had the amazing quality of forbearance, meaning how to teach people in a tolerant, kind, forbearant manner. That's why Sahaba would say, radiallahu anhum, إِنَّ مِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يُؤْتَى عِلْمًا وَلَا يُؤْتَى حِلْمًا. There are those who have acquired knowledge, Allah has blessed knowledge, with knowledge, and they do not have the gift of forbearance and tolerance. And there are those who have tolerance, forbearance, kindness, but they lack knowledge. But Shaddad, Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu, أُوتِيَ الْعِلْمَ وَالْحِلْمَ مَعَا. Allah has blessed him with knowledge, and the forbearance and the kindness and the compassion with which to disseminate and impart that knowledge in a manner that people benefit from him fully, and people love associating with him. Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu knew of this quality in Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu. That is why when there were so many governors who went to Hims, but the people could not manage them because of obviously the weakness in the people. But Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu had such a way that even people who couldn't benefit from others because of their weakness, but they loved him so much that they benefited from him tremendously. Like Hims was an area that so many governors couldn't manage to rule over them. And many a time they actually gave it up and they returned to Medina Munawwara. But Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu, when he took over the reins of Hims, people loved him, benefited from him, and were devoted to learning deen under his supervision and guidance. This is because of the amazing traits and qualities and feats in Hazrat Shaddad bin Aus radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu continued running the affairs of this area, Hims, that was known for the trials and the tribulations caused by the people there. But because they loved him so much, things went so well. And he continued running the affairs until the Shahada of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu anhu. When that happened, he was so hurt, he returned to Medina Munawwara. But after the Shahada of Hazrat Uthman radiallahu anhu, he realized that fitna had now befallen the Ummah. And this hurt him very much. So he gathered his family members and he left that region. He left Medina Munawwara and he went, obviously not out of disrespect for Medina Munawwara, but what happened there hurt him tremendously, hurt him immensely. When he now journeyed to another of the holy lands, he went to Palestine, another land of Allah, a very, very special land. The Masra Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the land from where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on the journey of Mi'raj. And this is the land of the first Qibla, Ula al-Qiblatain. So he went to these regions and he lived there with his family. But his heart always yearned for Makkah Mukarramah and Madinah Munawwara, the lands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There's an amazing incident narrated by a young man from the Mujashi' tribe. He says, I traveled from Sham, myself and some associates of mine, and we were on our way to Makkah Mukarramah. En route, we passed a simple area where we found some tents pitched. So I said to my friends, you know what? This man inside this big tent, Hadha al-Fustat, he seems to be one of the seniors here. Let's go. When we arrived there, we made salam. So the man standing there responded to our salam and lovingly, respectfully welcomed us. Not long after that, did a very elderly, senior individual appear. When we saw him, we were awe-stricken by him. We had such reverence for him, more than we ever had for our fathers or even the rulers, the Sultan. But he greeted us so well. فَحَيَّانَا. He greeted us with the full salam, and we responded with salam in a very respectful manner. He then said to us, "Where are you all off to?" We said, "We are young men. We are planning to go for Hajj. Lina umm al bayt al atiq." Going to the ancient Kaaba, to the sacred Kaaba. And when we said this, we realized the symptoms that appeared from his face, that our words actually created emotion in him, and he went down memory lane. And then he just said, "Wa ana tuhaddithuni nafsi bi an amdiya ila al-bayt al-haram." I'm also feeling I want to join you to Baytul Haram. "Wa sa ashabukum insha Allah." And if Allah helps me, I will come with you. We were very, very happy. We showed him that yes, you can join us. This was the beauty of that time. People going for Hajj, anyone can join, anyone can come. And then he called out. So there were many youngsters who came out from those other smaller tents. كأنهم النجوم الزهر. They were like bright stars. And they all gathered there. And they sat for his lecture. And he gave advices. وَأُصَاهُمْ. He gave such khutbas and advices and teachings. Subhanallah. Thus saying, إِنَّكُمْ يَا بَنِيَّ. O my beloved children. Subhanallah. How Sahaba radiallahu anhum would love the ummah and love the youth. And they treated all the youth as their own children. Let's show the ummah love like the Sahaba radiallahu anhum showed. Ya baniya, O my beloved children. Lam taro min al khayri illa atrafa. From the good, the so much of good that we saw, the abundance of good that we saw, you're not just seeing a bit of it. So obviously this is the humility of the Sahabi radiallahu anhu. He means, we saw Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you are seeing Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and we know how much of khair it is to see Sahaba radiallahu anhum. But then he is saying, وَلَمْ تَرَوْا مِنَ الشَّرِّ إِلَّا أَطْرَافَهُ أَيْضًا. Even from evil, you haven't seen much yet. But oh my children, وَلَا يَفُتْكُمْ. It mustn't, this message mustn't pass you. That أَنَّ الْخَيْرَ كُلَّهُ بِحَذَافِيرِهِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Good in totality. If you want all good, you'll only find that in Jannah. Subhanallah. So here he's alluding to one fact. That in dunya, no matter how your condition may be, it's always a mixture of two conditions. Goodness, good conditions, and bad conditions. No matter who it may be, no matter how rich the person may be, no matter how poor one may be, one will have to go through both in this world, because this world is the exam. If you want goodness in totality, you want the ultimate goodness, that you will only find in Jannah. And if you want ultimate evil, you want evil to the hilt, where something is only bad and evil, and that is in Jahannam. وَأَنَّ الشَّرَّ كُلَّهُ بِحَذَافِيرِهِ فِي النَّارِ. And then he said, oh my children, وَأَنَّ الدُّنْيَا عَرَضٌ حَاضِرٌ يَأْكُلُ مِنْهَا الْبَرُّ وَالْفَاجِرُ وَأَنَّ الْآخِرَةَ وَعْدٌ صَادِقٌ يَحْكُمُ فِيهَا مَلِكٌ عَادِلٌ. Oh my children, this world is shortly left. Everyone can acquire it. Whether one is obedient to Allah or one is defiant, Allah gives it to everyone. What he means is that if Allah gave you more of the world, it is not a sign that Allah loves you. It's not a sign that you are special, because the world is for everyone. Everyone partakes of it. وَأَنَّ الْآخِرَةَ وَعْدٌ صَادِقٌ. But akhirah is a true promise from Allah. And there, the judge is a just king. The judge is a just king. And here it also alludes to another hadith of Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wherein he said, Allah ta'ala gives dunya to everyone. Allah gives dunya to those who he loves, and those who disobey him as well. But Allah gives deen, وَلَا يُعْطِ الدِّينَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَحَبْ. Allah will only give deen, and the effort of deen, and the service of deen, and the ilm of deen to those who he loves. So it also could refer to this hadith. وَأَنَّ لِكُلِّ مِّنَ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ بَنُونَ. He says that dunya and akhirah both have children. فَكُونُوا أَبْنَاءَ الْآخِرَةِ. He says, I implore you that you make sure that you are the children of the akhirah. That you serve the Akhirah, because children serve their parents. You serve Akhirah to become the children of Akhirah. And do not become the children of this world. Subhanallah, subhanallah. And this is how he would gather these youngsters and sit with them and teach them. Because he joined them on this journey to Al-Masjid Al-Haram. So as he joined us, he left those other youngsters who were his students over there. And they really cried for his separation. And alhamdulillah, we were fortunate that we actually had him in our jamaat, in our group of travelers, to benefit from him. So we learn, always ask Allah Ta'ala for good company. And this is also the sunnah of Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Wherever they would go, they would say, "Oh Allah, yassir lana. Oh Allah, make it easy for us to find good company. People, through associating with them, they will connect us to you and enable us to get closer to you." This young narrator of this incident says, "I asked those around me, who is this man? Tafidul hikmatu min jawanibi, where hikmat and wisdom and knowledge flows from every limb of his." He said to me, this is Hazrat Shaddad bin Aws, Sahibu Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahabi of our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the son of his Sahabi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Not long after that, he asked them to prepare some, bring some sawiq, some bali, and he started breaking the bali and preparing the meal for us, and he was feeding us and giving us to drink. Subhanallah, despite his advanced age, look at Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Sahaba would make khidmat for everyone. Allahu Akbar. The lovers of Allah serve humanity. The lovers of Allah give others first. The lovers of Allah feed others. The lovers of Allah make salam to others first. Subhanallah. May Allah make us of those who will feed others, help others, serve others, give others, greet others, bring peace and happiness to others, speak politely, respectfully to others, and bring peace to humanity. Like the Sahaba of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. See this incident. Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu is feeding the youngsters who we would understand that they should be serving him, but he is serving them. And we find this throughout the Sahaba radiallahu anhu's lives. They made khidmah of humanity. So many of the tabi'een say, we joined the Sahabi to serve him, and throughout the journey he would look for every opportunity to serve us. Many Sahaba, we find incidents like this in regards to them. Even the contact that he had, he would go to Dimashq, the Khilafah of the Muslim world at that time, and he would ask for the fulfillment of the needs of all the people. Wherever people were suffering, he would make this request to the Khulafa, to the rulers, that people here are suffering, and immediately their needs would get fulfilled. People, they are going through whatever, immediately their needs would get fulfilled. But despite the position, the authority, the status he had from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he never used that for gaining any benefit for himself. On how many occasions they gave him gifts, he refused it. On how many occasions they wanted to pay his debts, he refused that. He just came to use his position and status to benefit humanity. He never used it for himself. Allah ta'ala forgive us, when we have contacts, we only use it for our own personal whims and fancies. But whatever contacts we have are from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as tests. If we use it in a manner that is halal and to serve others, to help the oppressed, help people in situations and conditions, Allah ta'ala will reward us and we will be passing our test. But if we use those contacts just for our own personal whims and fancies and to embezzle the funds of others unjustly, certainly we'll be doomed because of those contacts that we have. Hazrat Atta bin Abi Rabah rahmatullahi advised them, amongst them was Muhammad bin Suqa. He said to them, "Oh my nephew," now this is an address of love that a teacher and a tutor addresses his student with, "Yabna akhi, inna alladhina min qablina kanu yakrahuna fudul al kalam." The Sahaba hated and they abstained from futile speech. So I asked him, "Hazrat, what words, what speech is futile? Wama fudulul kalami indahum?" He said, "Everything is futile, except ma ada kitab Allah azza wa jalla an yuqra'a wa yufham, except Quran, to make tilawat of the Quran and studying the Quran, and except hadith Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an yurwa wa yudra, studying the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrating the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and studying the meanings of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and except amran bima'rufin wa nahyan 'an munkar, enjoining good, encouraging others towards good deeds, and helping others to stay away from evil deeds, stopping and forbidding others from wrongs and evil deeds, aw 'ilman yutaqarrabu bihi ila Allah 'azza wa jalla, or except knowledge, the acquisition of such knowledge that will grant one proximity to Allah. That will grant one closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And accept that you speak about your bare necessities. أن تتكلم بحاجتك ومعيشتك التي لا بد لك منها. What you have to utter. You're asking for these goods, asking the price for this or that. Whatever we have to utter and is our need to utter, for that also we would not be answerable. But besides that, anything else we say and we utter, we would be answerable for. Then he looked at me and he stared at me. حَدَّقَ إِلَىٰ وَجْهِ He stared in my face and he said, O my students, do you deny the verse? إِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ كِرَامًا كَاتِبِينَ In charge over you, Allah says, are certainly those angels guarding and protecting and writing down the honorable writers, writing down your every action. And do you deny that with every one of us, عَنِ الْيَمِينِ وَعَنِ الشِّمَالِ قَعِيدٌ مَا يَلْفِظُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ They are angels on his right and on his left, sitting. Every utterance he utters, except that this angel is watching and is ready and alert to document his every word. Then Hazrat Atta rahmatullah alayhi said, shouldn't one be ashamed that on the day of judgment when he opens his book of deeds and he finds that he filled his deeds throughout his days and when he sees his actions, he finds most of his efforts are all towards the worldly things of this life and he finds very little connected to the deen of Allah. Allah Ta'ala forgive us. Something else interesting to learn is sometimes a person does a certain action that is not an utterance. For example, he went to relieve himself and he didn't, obviously inside the bathroom he doesn't make zikrullah there. And whilst in the toilet, how will it be written down whether he went to relieve himself in the sunnah manner? How would the angels then know? So interestingly, ulama explained so beautifully that every action has a fragrance. When a person followed the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even in the restroom, the angel of Allah ta'ala, obviously who excuses himself and doesn't enter the restroom with him. And also, this angel of Allah ta'ala takes leave when a person is fulfilling the conjugal rights of his consort and his wife. So how then would the angel then be able to write down whether he fulfilled those actions in accordance to the sunnah as well? So then ulama explain that every sunnah has a fragrance and the angel of Allah knows what action was carried out or what sin was perpetrated through the beautiful scent or the stench that emanates from this human being. Like you and I, if a person obviously is fascinated about buying wonderful itar, utur, and good quality itar obviously is expensive. And just as a reminder, it is the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved itar. And in spite of the fact that his perspiration had a fragrance more fragrant than itar, Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam still used the best of itar. So we should not be extravagant in other things, but in itar we should use good itar, and there's reward in it because Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam used. That person who's passionate about itar would actually be able to tell whether it's asli or naqli, whether it's pure, original, or it's something that is fake, or it's a mixture, and so forth. Obviously these angels of Allah ta'ala are masters in their field. That's where Wahab bin Munabbi rahimahullah says so beautifully that when the mu'min who loved Allah and loved good company and attended the causes of deen and went into environments of piety and righteousness, the angels of Allah as he leaves the world congratulate him and pray for him and give him du'as that so many a time you made it so comfortable for us. You took us to wonderful environments. You took us to wonderful places. We enjoyed the wonderful fragrance of the environment. We can't appreciate you enough. And they thank him and they give him du'as. But when that banda who defied and denied and disobeyed and joined the bad company and went into bad places, those angels curse such individuals that you took us to such bad places and you made us suffer such foul smells. Allah Ta'ala save us. Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala save us. So Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu said, Remember this from me, that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا كَنَزَ النَّاسُ الذَّهَبَ وَالْفِضَّةَ فَكْنِزُوا هَذِهِ الْكَلِمَاتِ. When people will treasure and gather and hoard gold and silver, oh my Sahaba, oh my Ummah, you treasure these words, these du'as that your Nabi teaches. And Shaddad radiallahu anhu teaches these du'as. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam du'as. Allahumma inni as'aluka thabata fil amr, wa la azimata ala rushd. وأسألك شكر نعمتك وحسن عبادتك وأسألك يقينا صادقا وقلبا سليما وأسألك من خير ما تعلم وأعوذ بك من شر ما تعلم وأستغفرك لما تعلم إنك أنت علام الغيوب. Oh Allah, I ask you. Oh Allah, we ask you. الثبات في الأمر. Give us firmness and istiqama in deen. And oh Allah, give us determination on righteousness, that in the righteous path we are determined to follow it, that we do not give up easily, but we continue with determination in the path of righteousness. O Allah, enable us to appreciate Thy bounties. O Allah, enable us to perfectly worship You. Enable us to take pride in Your ibadat and worship. O Allah, give us sincere, true yaqeen, and give us clean hearts. O Allah, whatever good, all the good we ask You of, because You know it all, and we seek Your protection from the evil, that You know what is evil, You save us from that. And O Allah, we seek Your forgiveness, because You know all that we do. You know everything that is of the unseen. Subhanallah. Allah give us tawfiq to learn the du'as of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's why Hazrat Mullah Ali Qadi rahmatullah alayhi is Al-Hizbul A'zam, and Hazrat Mawlana Ashraf Ali Tanvi rahmatullah alayhi is Munajat Maqbool. These are du'as of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam compiled in these beautiful du'a kitabs that we should daily take our time to read. Hazrat Shaddad radiallahu anhu lived his life serving Allah's deen until when he left this world in a manner that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pleased with him. وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.